evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming here this evening for the Town Hall Speaker Series, which is co-sponsored by the Recreation Department and the Public Library. Those of you who don't know me, I'm Christine McIntosh. I am your library director. Our recreation director, Chuck Stover, is in the back. Tonight is the first part of our 2014-2015 Town Hall Speaker Series. In January, we will have Bob Cranmer here to talk about his recently published book, The Devil on Brownsville Road. So I do have some flyers here for that. But this evening, I know that you're all...
of your family or something like that. I just remember junior high years as being very important. The only thing different is now, I do now get to make these programs for WQED. And, I make two kinds of programs, basically. I make Pittsburgh programs for the Pittsburgh History Series for WQED. And because of the success we've had with those, I've also gotten to make national shows for PBS. And that's like the hot dog program and ice cream and Sure Things and great old amusement parks and programs like that that are national in scope. We do them exactly the same way. They are same crews, same techniques. It's just that we get to travel a little bit and, you know, hope we find interesting and cool places wherever we go. So I'm going to ramble tonight and reminisce. And I know that you're all missing Jeopardy right now, so I've brought a lot of quiz questions too. That's what I like to do, is ask questions. And we'll talk about Bethel Park, and maybe, I don't know, it seems to be a pretty savvy crowd. That's, some of you have been here longer than I have, so you may know all the answers. But I know one of the first questions people always ask, or sometimes it's the last question at the end of the evening, what are you working on now? I'm now working on two national shows for PBS, one on pies and one on bakeries. And it's a long story about how we, you know, working with PBS about the different topics. At first it was pies and pizza pies, and then they decided they wanted pies and cakes. And I said, there's too many shows about cake on TV. What about bakeries? Because I always think it's so important. The effect that a bakery can have on a neighborhood and a place. And I remember being so aware of that. After I graduated from school, I went to school in North Carolina. After I graduated from Bethel, I went to North Carolina to school, and then I worked for 11 years in South Carolina. And I know in the South there aren't bakeries like we have here. When I lived in Columbia, South Carolina, one of the few places open all night was the Krispy Kreme. And it was before everybody knew Krispy Kreme. But I can remember people would get tired of me because we would go to Krispy Kreme and, 1 o'clock in the morning, and everybody said, oh, these donuts are so good. And I said, oh, you know, they're all right. They're not as good as a bakery donut from where I come from. And I still think that. So we've started. We've been to New England. We've been to Indiana. Indiana has a state pie, the Hoosier pie, which is a sugar cream pie. And the state of Indiana even has a Hoosier pie trail that they've set up that you can follow. I didn't really like any of the things that they had specified, so we sort of made our own Hoosier pie trail while we were there. And everybody loves the sugar cream pie. It's very simple. No one there, we found no one in Indiana that called it a Hoosier pie. So they are Hoosiers, but they don't call their sugar cream pie, the state pie, a Hoosier pie. Only outsiders do that. If I'm doing a show on bakeries, obviously the next question is, are you going to do Bethel Bakery? And the Walshes are sitting right here. as I explained to them earlier, because we already did a story about Bethel Bakery and what makes Pittsburgh, Pittsburgh, I said, I think what I'm going to do is just do a little intro at the beginning of the show about the bakeries in my life and mention that I, you know, went to the first 6 years of grade school at St. Valentine's, and often after school we'd walk across to Bethel Bakery on the way to Gary Fox's house. Now that I work in Oakland, we're really close to Prantl's, and the Huffington Post this year said Prantl's has the best cake in America, the burnt almond tort. And so I thought maybe we could put together a little thing like that about all the bakeries that have influenced my life. The story that we do, I think, however, will be a longer story about the Minerva Bakery in McKeesport. It's been there since 1923. It is just an old-fashioned bakery, and it's really wonderful, and Mom and Dad still live up on the first floor above the bakery, and so it's really fun, and that will probably be our Pittsburgh story, except for this Bakeries of My Life segment. All of these things, the thing that I love most, I think, about what I get to do, and I really do love what I get to do, is that it seems to be perpetually surprising. I had a college professor, Dr. Armitage, at UNC in Chapel Hill, and I remember one day he said to us, you know, I know the students never want to hear this, but you will get tired of everything in life, except for one thing, learning new things. And it's absolutely true. I just love the fact that I get to do this exploring, I get to do research, I get to, you know, do fun investigations, trying to find out what's real and what's not real. And so I thought if this talk tonight has any sort of a title, which it probably doesn't, I would call it What the Dickens, There Are Lots of Surprises. All right, so I did some research for tonight. And after a little calculation, I realized that I probably should have waited one more year before saying, yes, I'll come and do a talk in Bethel Park at the community center, because I was surprised to see that next year, 2015, will be 50 years since I came to the junior high. I was a seventh grader in 1965, and yowza, no one ever expects to say you came here 50 years ago. Karen Urso says, thanks for reminding her. There are others of us here who remember that. So I read on, and I knew that the building that I remember, the junior high, I think we knew at that time that earlier it had been the high school. And so that wasn't such a big surprise when I was trying to find out what I could about the community center and the history of the space. I knew that, I think when my brother PK was around, this was Park Avenue Middle School. I mean, the building that was here. It's so confusing. the old junior high became Park Avenue School. But I was surprised to read that originally it was built to be an elementary school before it became the high school. And so, you know, there's always little surprises. What that means, if I can reminisce for just a second, that means it's 49 years since I was in Section 710. Almost 50 years since I met Miss Abernathy, who's now Carol Karn, and she's sitting right over here, who was the faculty sponsor of the drama club. And I was in the drama club both years that I was in junior high, and she and I are still friends. It's 50 years since I took gym with Mr. Phillips. And I don't know, there's something about gym class that we all remember so much about. It meant it's 50 years since I had art class with Miss Joyce down in the, it was sort of in the basement by the cafeteria. She's now Irene Patrick. And she came up and introduced herself to me one day at the Barnes & Noble in Greensburg. She lives in Greensburg. And we've stayed in touch ever since. She's a Facebook friend. And I think that's totally weird. Because when you're in the seventh grade, you think those teachers are so much older than you. And all of a sudden, you know, we're like the same age. I say it's also 50 years since I had Mrs. McMasters for social studies. Although I think at that time in the seventh grade, we called it world culture. I'm not sure of that, but I think seventh grade social studies was called world cultures. And a totally weird thing, earlier this year in February, my sister was over. We were working on my mom's house, which we're trying to empty and get ready to sell. We've been doing that for a while. And I knew they were there, so I thought, I'm going to stop and get some donuts at the bakery. And I went in and I got the donuts, and you put them in the box yourself or whatever, and the bag, and I took them over, and there was a very nice woman there who was going to wait on me, and she was smiling, and she's ringing me up, and she said, I know who you are, but you don't know who I am. And I said, okay. And she goes, I am Clara McMaster's granddaughter. And I said, wow, I remember Mrs. McMaster so well. And one of the things I truly do remember is that we did a big class project on Australia. And I was sort of like the chairman of that thing, and we put together a big book about Australia, and then I got to go to Australia, and I remember while I was there thinking, boy, you know, in seventh grade we did that thing. And so it's very odd what you remember and what influences you. But I said, I think Mrs. McMaster's died, and she said she did. She said, but I had to help, go through her things and decide what to keep and what not. And she said, I just wanted to tell you, it was right by Valentine's Day, across the street from St. Valentine's. She said, I have a Valentine that you made for my grandmother in the seventh grade. And then she laughed, and she said, I don't think anyone has ever said that before. I have a Valentine that you made for my grandmother in the seventh grade. So, I love surprises like that. She also did say, that's my daughter over there. That's Mrs. McMaster's great-granddaughter. So, it's Bethel Park. I now live in Regent Square, the neighborhood sort of beside Frick Park. You know, if you're in town, it's on the other side of the Squirrel Hill Tunnels. And I don't know, I found this out doing research. One of the biggest surprises of doing research is to see your own birth date, but I was born the day the Squirrel Hill Tunnels opened. no joke. June 5th, 1953, and we both turned 60 last year, and I made a show. You can actually watch it online. If you put in CBAC Squirrel Hill Tunnels, you'd see it. It's a half an hour, but I get us a shared birthday cake. So, I thought it would be fun. This will be our first trial question, okay? On these quiz questions, you have to raise your hand. If you scream out, I'll never know who's doing it. You have to raise your hand, all right? And I know, I apologize that they're so small. Maybe I would have tried to do bigger blow-ups or something if I knew how many people were going to be here. But this is Pittsburgh in the 1950s. And these are four major events in Pittsburgh history in the 1950s. A is Dr. Salk, starts his experiments with the polio vaccine, okay? And I've learned, because I've asked this question before, that I have to be specific. It's really when he starts his trials at the Arsenal School in Lawrenceville, which was one of the first public trials. There had been previously some secret trials. B is shipping port opens. And shipping port was the world's first nuclear power station on the Ohio River, just west of Pittsburgh. C is the Greater Pittsburgh Airport opens. Okay, that's the airport in Moon Township that's not there anymore. All right? And I remember my dad traveled a lot then. We would often go to the airport. It was just fun, and it was beautiful. They had fountains out front. And D is the last one, the Squirrel Hill Tunnels open. All these things happened in the 1950s, and what I'm asking you to do, please raise your hand if you want to give a guess. Put them in order. Which one happened first? Somebody. Okay, Karen. The order that they're in. No way. I'm not that easy. Come on. All right. Reverse order. That doesn't work either. Give it a shot. No. He said AD. That doesn't work. Someone else. Yes, sir. D? No. Yes, ma'am. No. Way in the back, yes. Yes. ADBC? ABDC. Not even close. No, someone asked that before. B is not first. Well, somebody want to give the whole, give it a try. Yes, sir. No, but you started good. So, you have to raise your hand. See, this is what happens. Yes, sir. No, C-A-D-B, not right. Oh, come on, somebody. There's only so many permutations. Go ahead, Karen. C-B-A-D, no. Yes, sir. No, but close. He said C-D-B-A. Come on, someone else. Yes. C-D-A-B. She was not a plant. Christine from the library. That's exactly right. The airport opens in 1952. That's the first thing on the list. The tunnels opened the day I was born, June 5th, 1953. So 52 is the airport, 53 is the tunnel. Dr. Salk at the Arsenal School is 54, and shipping port doesn't happen until 1957. Okay? Now, you get a prize. So, and you can have, I have a bunch of different DVDs. And I'll just take the first ones that popped out. You can have your choice of one. I have A History of Pittsburgh and 17 Objects, the newest of the programs on DVD. Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh, because it's that time of year. Or Underground Pittsburgh, the newest one. History of Pittsburgh and 17 Objects. Very good. All right. So, that day that I was born, the day the Squirrel Hill Tunnels opened, I was not born in Bethel Park. I was born at Southside Hospital, but my parents lived here already on Sylvania Drive. They came here in 1949, and we lived there till we moved to Priscilla Drive when I was five. My sister Nisi and I now own that house. But talking about being born at Southside Hospital makes me think of one of my favorite trivia questions related to births. I find it interesting that both of my parents were born at home. So that we're the generation where it seemed to change. My parents were born at home, both in Hazelwood, like in a bed at home, which seems so medieval. but all of us are born in hospitals. My brother Skip was born in Cannonsburg, and so we always said he was a foreigner having been born in Washington County. not PK, Skip. So Nisi and PK were both born in St. Clair. So I figured they were, you know, born at home. There must have been a midwife involved. It's just amazing. Anyway, the question that I love, and I can't even remember where I first heard this, but I love it. Please raise your hand if you want to give a guess. Don't holler out. Who was the first American president born in a hospital? Yes. John Kennedy. That was my guess, but it's wrong. He was born at his house. I've actually been there in Brookline, Massachusetts. You can see the, you can go in and tour the house where he was born. Someone else, yes. Jimmy Carter is exactly right, which I think is unusual. In, it's 1924, I think it's July of 24. He lived way out in rural Georgia. He seems to be the least likely candidate for hospital, but Miss Lillian said she wanted him to be born in a hospital. So 1924, Jimmy Carter. I'm gonna give you a choice. What have I got? I have Things That Aren't There Anymore, a classic. What Makes Pittsburgh, Pittsburgh? And the next to newest one, 25 Things I Like About Pittsburgh. What Makes Pittsburgh, Pittsburgh? With the excellent story about Bethel Bakery. Thank you. All right. So a couple of years ago, several years ago, I think, I went and talked to a class at George Washington Elementary School over on Clifton Road. And in preparation for that, I made a question, which I've always thought, like, why am I keeping this? Why am I keeping this board? And I think it's because I knew I would be here tonight. All history is local. Here are four events. A, South Park is established, okay? B, Bethel Bakery opens. C, Bethel Presbyterian Church is organized. And D, the Liberty Tubes open, okay? So these are four events that influence everybody, I think, who lives in Bethel Park. So, yes, ma'am, wanna give it a shot? Exactly right. Wonderful. I only went through sixth. Okay, so Pittsburgh 17 objects, Underground Pittsburgh, 25 things, or things that aren't there anymore? 25 things. And because you were right on the first time, you get an extra prize. My mother had these for some reason. I'm going to give you two Bethel Park centennial plates. 200 years, it says 1776 to 1976. I don't know that I've ever seen 1776 as our day, or whether this was just for the centennial year, the bicentennial year here in Bethel. But so you get two Bethel Centennial Plates and a copy. if you're interested in the years, and this may be where the 1776 comes from, Bethel Presbyterian Church is founded. I'm sorry? The tubes are 1924. Exactly right. That's excellent. Five is what I have written down here. I know, but to know all those dates, I don't think I know those dates. I have them written on the back of the card here. Thank you. I'm sorry? Oh, he would like you to give the rest of the talk. I don't know, I am a little intimidated because I had a couple of Bethel Park questions, but one of them was based, when I did the story about Bethel Bakery, I met Leonard Tischler. He had come down, and I interviewed him, and we talked for a while. And he actually talked to me about something which I'd never known, and it's one of those surprises that I love. How did Bethel Park get its name? And so the way I've written the question is, it had been Bethel Township, and then it was Bethel Borough. But my question is, why did we have to find a new name in the late 1950s? I'm not sure if it's official till 1960, but what was new in town? See, lots of people know. She said the magic words. The magic words are post office. That's when we got a post office in Bethel Park. And you know how that came about? Who made that connection between Bethel? There, sorry. She said because Bethel Park was so close to South Park. And that's what Mr. Tischler told me as well. But do you know anything else about who did that? Mr. Tischler told me that a teacher in the Bethel High School, there had been a competition, and she was the one who suggested leaving the word Bethel and adding the word park because we were so close to South Park. So happy holidays in Pittsburgh. What makes Pittsburgh Pittsburgh? Or 25 things? What makes Pittsburgh Pittsburgh? I'll watch you do it. Thank you. Because I've been going through lots of papers and stuff at the house, I was interested in, actually, I'm going to be a vendor at a vintage sale this weekend in Lawrenceville. And one of the things that I found, that we found in the back of one of the cupboards in Mom's kitchen, was a box of aluminum molds that are in the shape of a cooked chicken. They've never been used. The box is still there, the box they were shipped in, from Miro, M-I-R-R-O. And I put them on Facebook and said, I'm bringing these. They're in the original box. And it says Sylvania Drive, Pittsburgh 34, PA. So that's sort of Castle Shannon and parts of Mount Lebanon. But that's what Sylvania Drive was, obviously, in 1956, Pittsburgh 34. And then at the house there on Priscilla, I actually found this. We were the second owners of that house. The first owners were the Beatles, B-E-E-D-L-E-S, the Beatles. We always loved that as kids. The Beatles owned our house. And this is the assessment, the Allegheny County assessment in 1956. And the address is Breezewood Manor, Library RD2, PA. So that's why we needed our own post office. It was actually, they were petitioning for it to be upped from 8,500 to 9,200. So hopefully more. I also did a show a couple of years ago called North Park versus South Park. And I didn't even get to include this, but it was one of the surprises that I loved. It's interesting to compare, and it was all, I say this in the show, that a cameraman who lives up near North Park challenged me. Hey, you know, North Park is bigger than South Park. So I said, well, you don't have any buffalo. And he said, we have a lake, you know. And so I got to learn a lot about South Park, which I never knew growing up. We were supposed to have a lake, but it never happened. And there's all kinds of politics, of course, involved in county politics and the whole sort of, and now that it's been pointed out, I say like, oh yeah, there are these very rustic parts of South Park, you know, with the little picnic shelters and things like that, and the old water place at Stone Manse and the old swimming pool, which I remember very well, that had the rocks that came out. That's all very rustic and very American. But then there are other very formal places, like the Joyce Kilmer Memorial in the middle of Corrigan Drive that looks like something out of Europe. And what it is it's two different guys in charge of the park, and the first one liked American rustic, and the next one liked European formality. So we get both of those in South Park. But Corrigan Drive, I have two questions. We can do it in two parts, but I really, let's try to give them both and see if anybody can get both, okay? That main road through the park, it's named Corrigan in 1938. And it's named for Douglas Corrigan. And my first question is, what did he do? What did Douglas Corrigan do to get that road named for him? And what was the road called before it was called Corrigan Drive? Anybody? Somebody didn't raise their hand. I don't know who hollered. Yes, Wrong Way Corrigan is right. And maybe he'll get full credit if you can tell me what that road used to be called. Somebody else know? Catfish Run is exactly right. So I'll give you both a prize. Give them both one. I don't think I'd ever heard that, Catfish Run. But that's the stream that goes alongside Corrigan Drive, Catfish Run. That was the name of the road until 1938, when Douglas Corrigan came to Pittsburgh. It was the 150th anniversary of Allegheny County. And he came here in September of 1938. I can't tell if he ever got to South Park. I think the county was just so grateful that he came here. He had flown across the Atlantic Ocean in July of 1938. He had been approved to fly to San Francisco from the East Coast, and something went wrong with his instruments, and he ended up in Ireland. So he was always known as Wrong Way Corrigan. He is a great character. And it's really funny, I think I grew up, and no one ever told me that Corrigan Drive is named for Wrong Way Corrigan. He lived to be quite old. He never once said, I did it on purpose. Even though everyone assumes he did it on purpose, he always said, I just made a mistake, and flew all the way to Ireland. He wanted to duplicate what Lindbergh had done, and he did. And Catfish Run, people are often attracted to water. People want to live by water. So this is one of my favorite questions. Why are we all here in Pittsburgh? Here are five local rivers. Rivers around here, okay? A is the Mon. B is the Yauk. C is the Allegheny. D is the Beaver. And E is the Kiski. Okay? All rivers around here. Put them in order, shortest to longest. You can guess. There's a guess. You want to guess? I'm sorry? E? Go ahead. B? D, E, D. Not close enough. Somebody else. Yes. No, I'm sorry, he's wrong. I probably gave that impression because I let him go. E is not the first one. Now knowing that, what do you do? I'm sorry? D. Then E. No. BC8, no. Yes, sir. No. Yes. C8. C-A-B. I think somebody already guessed that, but go ahead, Karen. So close, but no cigar. Yes. No, that's already been guessed, I know. Here, one more for somebody that hasn't tried. Yes, go ahead. No. Okay, try again. No. In the back. DB ABC is exactly right. All right. So you get a prize, all right? I may give out all my prizes on this one because I have a lot of questions, all right? So I've always enjoyed the fact that this is from a Brian O'Neill article in the Post-Gazette. Usually when two rivers come together, they keep the name of the bigger river. In world geography, that's pretty common. You know, there are big tributaries that flow into bigger rivers. And that's what the French thought. The French thought the Allegheny and the Ohio were the same river. They called it La Belle Rivière. The English thought it was two different rivers that came together and formed a third. And the British won the French and Indian War, so we adopted their point of view. We have two rivers that come together here in Pittsburgh and form the Ohio, okay? But there are other places around here where that same thing happens. Two rivers come together with different names that form a new one, all right? So, the shortest river on here is the Beaver. It's 21 miles long, okay? I'll give you a prize if you can tell me where it begins or the two rivers that come together to form it. It's hard. Carol Karn, do you know? Yes, sir. Wow, you're close. That's one of them. Take it. You know another river up there? Yes, in the back. No. No. How about the town? Anybody know the town? Yes. He said Shenango, right? Yeah. But, yes. Mahoning. Okay, so we have the two rivers, but that's too many. I can't give out that many prizes. The Shenango and the Mahoning come together and form the Beaver. Where? Anybody? Not in Beaver. It ends at Beaver. It flows into the Ohio at Beaver. Newcastle is right. I'll give you the prize. I'm going to give you happy holidays. All right? Although I probably should have saved that. Yeah, here. I have some things that aren't there anymore. Did I give that one away? I don't have it. How about it's the neighborhoods? There we go. It's not there anymore. Somebody else got it. Okay, back to the rivers. Okay. The Allegheny. Yawk. It comes together, it actually starts in Silver Lake, Maryland. I skipped the Kiski, didn't I? The Kiski's next. Beaver, then Kiski. The Kiski is the largest tributary of the Allegheny River. All right? I'll do the same thing. What two rivers come together or where? Anybody? Any guesses? Vandegrift is near where it ends, but it's not where it starts. It's how the Johnstown flood, or some of the Johnstown flood got to Pittsburgh along the Kiski. I love it. Its real name is the Kiskaminitus, but we know the word Kiski because of Alley Kiski Valley and the Kiski School and all of that. Yes? The Conemaugh is where it, I think that's what it is in... when it comes out of Johnstown, and that's one of the two rivers that come together. But anybody else? No, anybody know the other river? The Conemaugh and the what come together to form the Kiski? The Loyal Hannah. And that's at Salzburg, Pennsylvania. So you're going to get one of these, I know. I'm not desperate to give you a prize because you already have one there. All right. The next river is the Mon. All right. I think we learned in grade school around here that the Mon is one of the rare rivers in the northern hemisphere that flows north. Some people think it's the only one, but it's not. There are lots of rivers. Well, there are some rivers that flow north in the northern hemisphere. The Mon is one of them. How about the two rivers that come together or the place where it starts? Yes. That's exactly right. You get a prize. Fairmont, West Virginia. Usually when I say it's the hometown of Mary Lou Retton, for some reason someone knows that. How about 25 things? Good. All right, the Youghiogheny. It starts in Silver Lake, Maryland. If you're interested in the lengths, the Beaver was 21 miles long, the Kiski is 27 miles long, the Mon is about 130 miles long. The Youghiogheny, believe it or not, is longer than the Mon. It's 134 miles long. I will give you a prize. Raise your hand if you'd like to guess. If you can spell Youghiogheny. Yes, sir. That's very good. That's exactly right. He got the hard part. It's the I-O in the middle. It's really the Youghiogheny, but we don't say that. It's the Youghiogheny. So, prize. Underground. All right. The Allegheny is about 325 miles long. It starts in north central Pennsylvania around the town of Cowdersport. It goes north into New York State, does a big U-turn, and comes back into Pennsylvania in what's now called the Kinzu Reservoir or the Allegheny Reservoir near the town of Warren, Pennsylvania. And it flows, winds its way down to Pittsburgh. At the point in Pittsburgh, it meets the Monongahela and forms the Ohio. The Ohio is longer than 1,000 miles. I mean, the Allegheny is longer than all the other rivers here put together. It's 325 miles long. When it becomes the Ohio, it flows west for over 1,000 miles. It ends when it flows into the Mississippi River. If you follow what Brian O'Neill said in his column was, if we adopted the other way of naming rivers, there would be no Ohio. The Allegheny River puts more than twice as much water into the Ohio as the Mon. And so it really should be the Allegheny, if you follow that logic. And then when the Ohio meets the Mississippi, it's twice as big as the Mississippi. So if you follow that logic, it should be the Allegheny all the way to New Orleans. But we don't do that. So my question, my last question from here, I'll give you a prize. If you can tell me the name of the town where the Ohio River ends. Yes, sir. Cairo, Illinois. They say Cairo. But that's good. You get a prize. Let's give them happy holidays, okay? I'm almost... Oh, no, I have several left. And I have more plates. I should have been giving out more plates. All right. I also wanted to mention tonight, in talking about surprises, I never heard of this when I was growing up here, but when I was living here with my mom several years ago now, I used to stop and have a bagel often in the morning with those guys that hang out at the Brugger's down in South Park Shops. And when I first started to do that, one day they were talking, one of them had moved here to Bethel in 1927, and he remembered, he said, "Do you know about that armored car robbery?" And I said, "No." And he said, "There was an armored car robbery over there on Brightwood Road." And so I started to do some research, and it was the first armored car robbery in the world, which I say, we really should have a historic marker there. I think I didn't believe it. Until I started to do some research, and it was a Brinks truck, and I called Brinks in Chicago, And I said to the guy, I said, I'm doing some research, and there was a robbery in just south of Pittsburgh. He goes, the Library Road robbery. I said, well, yes. He said, that's one of the two most important events in our history. because at the time, armored cars had wooden bottoms. And that's how they blew up the armored car. A gang from Detroit called the Flathead Gang, led by a man named Paul Jaworski, essentially put a landmine under Brightwood Road. They dug it up, put dynamite in, and I think from some of the things, it seems like they had one of those plungers like you see in a cartoon. They knew that the Brinks truck would drop off the payroll at Molinar, at the mine, I think on Friday afternoon, and then it would go to Coverdale and drop off the payroll there. So they knew the route that the Brinks truck took every week, and they planted this dynamite under the road, right there where Brightwood meets 88. And they blew up the truck when it went over. And they successfully did it. It even had a, sort of a, not a chase vehicle, but a companion vehicle, and it got both of them. And the guys in the truck were so surprised, they didn't resist at all. There was no shots. They blew the bottom of the truck apart, however, and they were able to reach in, and they took $104,000. Paul Jaworski is captured down in Washington County near Bentleyville, I think he had $30,000. The rest of the money has never been found. But it's such a good sort of Bonnie and Clyde story right here in our backyards. I thought I wanted to mention it tonight because it was such a great surprise and such a good story. It's also right there by Giant Eagle and Walmart. And there's now a Asian restaurant there called the Rice Inn. And I don't know if you saw this, but earlier this year, Ken Rice from KDKA, from KDKA News, was there. He did a story. He interviewed a guy named Mike Nielsen about a phenomenon called UTBAFs. And we have an UTBAF in Bethel Park. That's why they were there. Does anybody know what an UTBAF is? Yes, sir, in the back. Exactly right. An UTBAF is a used to be a Pizza Hut. And actually, Mike Nielsen is a guy here in Pittsburgh. He lives out west of town. He has a great website called utbaf.com. And he started it because he knew how people in Pittsburgh would say stuff like, "What term with the, you know, where the Pizza Hut used to be." But Pizza Huts are pretty distinctive in their architecture. And so now he has Pizza Huts, used to be a Pizza Hut. It can't still be a Pizza Hut. It has to be one that's changed. People have sent them in from all over the world. But he chose to come to the Rice Inn with Ken Rice because that used to be a Pizza Hut. I'm going to let you come up. 25 things? Here, way in the back. So, I talk about surprises. I wanted to acknowledge the library because when I first started to put these things together, I thought I was going to be in the library because the last time I spoke, I was at the library. It was a much smaller room. But that library, I don't know, I guess it's partly my mom who, you know, told us we could always walk to the library. I could walk to the library from our house easily from the time I was 5. And I tried to look online, and there's some library history, but nobody mentions. I remembered it as being in a mobile vehicle that parked right there in front of the borough building. And, I'm sorry? Was it a bookmobile? But it seemed to be the library too. Although the histories say that it was in the little old schoolhouse here. Oh, so, well, I'm going to say, you know, we moved here in 58. So it started in 55, but I think it was in the basement of the old school over there. but it was just so important. And I, at the time, when you took a book out, I think your card put on the date that you had to bring the book back. And they were like, no, it wasn't like that. It was a four-sided thing, I think. They had a machine. It would go clunk, clunk. Yeah. And you would fill up the card. And I remember, we lived so close, and I loved the library so much that I remember I probably was six when I filled my first card. And the librarian, I remember, made such a fuss. I think you're the youngest person who has ever filled a card. And I was so proud. And so I just wanted to say thank you to the library, you know. It's such a wonderful thing, and I still go to the library all the time, not here, but that's where I go to find out some of these surprises. It'll be 60 years old next year. Okay, so get ready for that. I'm sure they'll be looking for contributions. That's what we all do. But that's where I go to find history, and I see that I really have about 5 minutes left. That's enough about the library. I was going to ask a question about Pittsburgh history, but I go to the library. I write a column for Pittsburgh Magazine. I used to write the back page, but now I write a column that they call All Roads Lead to Pittsburgh. And every month I try to find a famous visitor. And I love the surprises that I find. A lot of them I find at the Carnegie Library in Oakland, where they have these things called vertical files. Actually, I have it as one of the 25 things I like about Pittsburgh in that show, is the Pennsylvania Department with their vertical files. Since the 1890s, librarians have cut articles out of newspapers and put them in files. And there's information there that you cannot find online. And so that's what I love. I love those vertical files that teach me about things that I don't think I'd find online. I think one of my favorite ones that I've written was about Charles Dickens. Charles Dickens came to Pittsburgh when he was 30 years old. He came with his wife and his wife's servant. They stayed for 3 days. They were on a 5-month tour of America, which he wrote up. I think it's called American Notes. And actually, I think I put the thing here because I loved, he's kind of snide. He was already world famous at the age of 30. I think he'd written Oliver Twist, but there were still a lot of other books still to come. Apparently, when he got here to Pittsburgh, everybody said, we are just like Birmingham in England. And he wrote, the book is called American Notes for General Circulation. He said, Pittsburgh is like Birmingham in England. At least its townspeople say it is. Setting aside the streets, the shops, the houses, wagons, factories, public buildings, and population, perhaps it may be. But he liked Pittsburgh, and he really liked the hotel. I always marvel at how much detail is preserved in some of these old articles. The room that he stayed in the hotel, it was called the Exchange Hotel. I think it was where Hines Hall is now. And the room cost $1.50 a night. He stayed in room 12. And there was a newspaper here then called the Morning Chronicle. And someone writing for the newspaper heard that he was here. And he was internationally known already as a young, promising writer. His first book was called Sketches by Boz, B-O-Z. And Boz was his pen name. And there was the little article in the paper that said, Boz in town. And so people were excited. People read a lot more. And they wanted to meet this guy. And so he agreed to meet people in his hotel in the afternoon for an hour or two every day. And so when I went to the vertical file and I was doing research on this, everybody tells those same details. You know, this happened. He came here 3 days, blah, blah, blah. His wife was afraid of steamboats, and she knew that they would have to get on a steamboat to go west. And she was afraid of them blowing up, so she wanted him to find the safest steamboat. But when I going through all these files, I think there was like one more article to read, and I thought, oh, do I have to do this? Do I have to read one more? But my favorite thing was there. When he received people at the hotel room, someone wrote down everyone's name who came to visit. And among the visitors at his hotel room on those 2 or 3 days when he was here in town was the mayor of Allegheny City, which is the north side before it was absorbed into Pittsburgh. That doesn't happen until 1907, I think. But Charles Dickens was there. Someone wrote down all the people. The mayor came. The mayor's name was Colonel William Foster. And he brought with him his 16-year-old son, Stephen Foster. And so I said, you know, sometimes now you'll hear people call Pittsburgh the Pop City. But if we are the Pop City, that's the moment it happened, when the great pop novelist met the great pop songwriter, not knowing that they would, you know, have the success that they did. But I think it's a really magical moment, and I love stuff like that, telling little detail. He was 30, it was 1842 that Charles Dickens was here. And since we're so close to Christmas, I thought maybe it wouldn't be too bad. These are 19th century Christmas traditions, okay? A is, it came upon a midnight clear. B is A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. C is Jingle Bells. D is A Visit from St. Nicholas. That's 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. And E is We Three Kings of Orient Are. So I want you to put them in order. Which one happens first? What's first through last? Christmas traditions that we still all know. Anybody? It's a guess. I know it's a guess. I'm sorry? I can't tell who's talking. Right there, D. D is first. It's a good guess. So you have to give the rest now. Come on. But you had the right beginning. So did you hear that he said D was first? Okay. So you want to give it a try? That's 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. No. Anybody else? Okay, Karen, come on. No. She said D-A. It's not D-A. Let one more person try, and then I'll come back to you. Someone else. Yes, sir. D-E-B-C-A. Now, we'll do one more, just so it doesn't get tiresome. Yes, sir. Which one was first? D, which is 'Twas the Night Before Christmas. All right. Not E. Guess another one. B is exactly right. So you got the first two. D-B, that's A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. That's Ebenezer Scrooge and all of that. That's the second one. If you want the dates, 1822 is A Visit from St. Nicholas, okay? And then 1843, the year after he was here, Charles Dickens wrote A Christmas Carol, all right? Now, so that's the first two. DB, what comes next? I'm sorry? Listen to what she's saying right up here. C, exactly right. That's Jingle Bells, 1857. Okay? So we got the first three. Come on, you can do it. You're going all the way. No. I'm sorry? E? E is right. After Jingle Bells comes We Three Kings of Orient Are. All right, and what's last? An A. A is the carol. It was written in 1859. The words are older, but that's the year that the music was put to the poem. It came upon a midnight clear. We Three Kings is 1863. My article for Pittsburgh Magazine in January will be about We Three Kings. And this is one of my best surprises of the last week or two. First of all, isn't it funny that carol is written in Yoda talk? We Three Kings of Orient are. That's the way Yoda talks in Star Wars. I always remember it was my father's favorite Christmas carol. My father loved We Three Kings of Orient Are. I was looking for some sort of story for this All Roads Lead to Pittsburgh. And I was talking to somebody at work, and I said, you know, it's got to be a little bit holiday-oriented, but it'll come out the week of Christmas, so people won't mind if it has a little bit of Christmas connection, but maybe it'd be nice if it were a baby. Because, you know, the new year is always portrayed as a baby. And this guy, he's one of my cameramen, he went away, and he came back an hour later, and he goes, I got something for you. And I said, what? And he said, I have something for Pittsburgh Magazine. He said, John Henry Hopkins, Jr., born in Pittsburgh in 1820. He became a minister. His father was a minister. His father, John Henry Hopkins, Sr., eventually became one of the prime bishops of the Episcopal Church. He had been the bishop of Vermont, but he lived here in Pittsburgh for a while. He built St. Paul's Church in Zelianople in 1826. It's still there. So, but my guy, the son, one of 13 children, of the guy who built that church in Zelianople, where Zeli actually attended services. Zeli, for whom Zelianople is named, went to St. Paul's. But one of his 13 children, and one of the first, who would have been six when he built that church, only lived here in Pittsburgh till he was 10. But he would go on, and he also became a minister, and he worked for the General Seminary. He was teaching at the General Seminary in New York City in 1957. When he wrote, We Three Kings of Orient Are, a guy from Pittsburgh. It's astounding to me. I'd never heard that before. So if you get the January issue of Pittsburgh Magazine, that will be. Now, who answered this question? You did. You get a prize. Come on up. Do you want to? You can pick. So this is Pittsburgh and 17 Objects, Underground, Happy Holidays, and there's a What Makes Pittsburgh Pittsburgh over there. Happy Holidays, wait a second. You also get a Bethel Park Blackhawks license plate. It's vintage. All right. I could go on, but I think that's enough. I promised Christine I would also take questions. If anybody has a question, I'd be happy to answer. Yes, ma'am. The Pi special, it will probably be on PBS in the summer of 2015. I think we hope to finish in April, early May at the latest. It'll be on in June or July, just because PBS tends to run my things in the summer. Yes. Have I kept in touch with some? Yes, I have. Yes. I do keep in touch with Beth Snodgrass. Do you know her? Yeah, I think she passed away. Yes, she passed away not long, I think, after the show came out. She was 80-something when we did the show. Mary died last year, and that was, you know, I think that's the most famous moment in any of my Pittsburgh shows, when Mary Wooliber on Troy Hill runs out to the edge of the hill and says, you know, like, look at that, do you see now why I want to live here? but it looks like the beginning of The Sound of Music with her running out there. No, this is very interesting. In the last show that I did, A History of Pittsburgh in 17 Objects, but this is like Pittsburgh, One of the objects is a duck pin, because duck pin bowling was so popular around here, and there's even a kind of duck pin bowling which was prevalent here called rubber band duck pins, where there's a rubber band around the pin. Oddly enough, always called rubber band duck pin, not gum band, but always called rubber band duck pins. And I wanted to do a story about that, and I found the Glassport Lanes in Glassport still packed. And I went over and talked to them and said, when should we come? And they said, oh, you have to come on a Saturday night. It turned out we went Holy Saturday night, and it was packed. The league that plays on Saturday nights has been doing it for 56 years every Saturday night. And so those guys really know and love each other, and it's all men. but we had a great time, and we interviewed the two oldest guys who had been there for 56 years. I can't believe I'm not going to think of his name. But anyway, we gathered our stuff, we did our interviews, we watched them play, we did all that. And on Easter Monday, I got a phone call, and the one guy that we interviewed had died. Which had never been so close before. You know, we just interviewed him on Saturday night. On Monday, he died. And he had been gathering things to give to us because he was sort of their historian. It was Beth Snodgrass who called me. Beth Snodgrass is the girl in Kennywood Memories whose eyes go back and forth with the wave swinger. But it was her uncle. So I said, but you know, that's just the way it is here in Pittsburgh, that everybody knows everybody or is related somehow. But she called me just to say, I want you to know my uncle died because I know you interviewed him on Saturday night. Yes? When we did the Pennsylvania Roadshow a long time ago, the first story in the show is about the Linesville Spillway on Lake Pymatuning, where the ducks walk on the fish's backs, where the carp are so thick and you throw bread to the carp, and it's kind of disgusting and cool. my uncle had a cottage at Pymatuning, I think since before I was born, and for a long time that was the only summer holiday we ever took, was to go up to Uncle Mike's at Pymatuning, and we would always go to the Linesville Spillway. I think we would take bread from here, you know, take the stale bread, go throw it to the fish. So when I did that story, the only expert I knew about the Linesville Spillway was my dad. So I took him, and it's nice. It's the summer of 92, maybe the summer of 91. But it looks great, and every so often, every time it comes on, my brother and sister and I, we always say, hey, Dad's on. And it's really nice because he's so alive and, you know, he's on videotape. It's really nice. It's a nice reminder. So. Yes. That's a really good question. Because that never happens. I'll tell you, not right now, but for the last 3 years, I did a weekly show called It's Pittsburgh and a lot of other stuff. I love that. I love the freedom of that, because usually I'm locked into a topic, and whether it's the Strip District or, you know, the Lincoln Highway or whatever, if it doesn't fit into those parameters, I can't do it. But when I was doing It's Pittsburgh, I could do anything, and I like that. I like that freedom. I like that because we were going to go do a story, which eventually we did. It's in 17 Objects about this guy that made neon signs in McKeesport. He got sick, and he couldn't. We couldn't go there. I said, well, we're going to have to find something to do. He canceled at the last minute, and I had a crew, and you always want to use the crew. And the cameraman said, well, let's just go to Millville, because you're going to do a story about the bakery there. We ended up doing a whole show about Millville, unplanned. But I didn't know anything about Millville, and I loved learning about it. And it's a really cool little community, and it's had terrible floods, but it survives. And I love that. I like that. That's what I would want to do. I would like to do a regular Pittsburgh show forever if I could, you know. Because I think, you know, if sometimes people ask what's my favorite show, and I say, oh, I can't tell you, but I think it's a hot dog program, or maybe Sandwiches That You Will Like. I love those two shows. They're both national shows, and you can't. No one loves a national show the way Pittsburghers love a Pittsburgh show. And in general, I love the local shows more than I love the national shows, but my favorite two shows are national shows. So it's just, it's weird. I've always wanted to do, in fact, I did a national show about cemeteries. I would like to do a local show about cemeteries, but no one ever wants to give me the money. Too many people on the boards of those foundations are old and they don't want to. Think about the inevitable, you know? Yes, sir. Hey, how are you? I didn't even see you sitting there.
Hello there.
Mr. Rogers, John Rogers, right?
Yeah. You're
right. I know him from Lady Di's over on South Park Road. Yes, I did a bike article about him and his bikes. He had an old bike.
Did you ever finish that beer?
Oh, I think I I would still like to do something about beer. Craft beer, but I haven't done anything. Yeah, I'm always doing research about beer. I don't think I've done a beer story. I might have. I mean, I think I did something about Penn Brewery over on the north side in Northside Story, because that was Eberhardt and Ober. That's right. I know that, actually, the guy who's opening the microbrewery down there where, the train, what was that, Duke's Station, that guy lives in my neighborhood in Regent Square. We have a picnic every year, and he came up and he goes, hey, you know, I think you're from Bethel Park. I said, I am. He goes, I'm building a little microbrewery out there. So he said he's probably going to move to Bethel. Anybody else? Another question? Yes. Oh, what's the most popular? I think Kennywood Memories still is the biggest seller, although Things That Aren't There Anymore is a very close second. Actually, one of the things I'm most proud of is which of the Pittsburgh programs has been seen in more cities than any other? And somebody at one time, I asked that question. They said, we can find that out. We can figure that out. And the answer was Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh has aired in more markets across the country than any other Pittsburgh show. And I think it's because it's really multicultural. That year we were really lucky. You know, not only do we have Hanukkah and Christmas together, but Ramadan was at that time of year then. Ramadan moves through the years. But it was really a good thing. And still, it's going to air on the Neighborhood Channel next month. Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh. So, yes. What was my favorite one making? I never like to say, but it was probably a hot dog program. Yeah. It's hard work tasting all those hot dogs. Okay. That looks like it. Thank you all very much for coming.